Hello everyone, this is Dr. Utsav Ganguly, Junior Resident, Department of Radio Diagnosis, Pandit B.B. Sharma, PGIMS, Rohtak. The topic of my presentation is Role of Magnetic Resonance Imaging in Evaluation of Salivary Gland Masses. Humans have three pairs of major salivary glands, parotid, submandibular, and sublingual. Neoplasms of the salivary gland may be benign or malignant. Examples of benign tumors are pleomorphic adenoma, Wharton tumor, and oncocytoma. Malignant tumors include mucoepidermal carcinoma, acinic cell carcinoma, and adenoid cystic carcinoma. Salivary gland swelling most commonly present as masses in the jaw or neck region. Benign masses are usually asymptomatic. Some other symptoms include pain or dysphagia. Sudden increase in size, increased pain, and patient nerve palsy may indicate malignant change. Imaging plays an important role in the visualization of morphology and functions to establish a diagnosis for treatment and surgical planning. Available modalities include ultrasound, radiography, xylography, CT, MRI, scintigraphy, and PET scan. In children and pregnant women, USG is considered the first step, especially for lesions in the superficial lobe of the parotid. For further characterization of tumors, cross-sectional imaging like CT or MRI must be performed. CT is a modality of choice for patients with a clinical history and findings suggestive of inflammatory conditions like parotiditis or salivary. Similarly, recurrent subacute episodes of mildly painful or tender parotid or submandibular swellings are best assessed on a CT. MRI is the preferred modality for the evaluation of salivary gland tumors because it gives us a better soft tissue resolution and an assessment of extraglandular and perineural spread. Also, it does not employ any ionizing radiation. The aims and objectives of our study was to evaluate the role of MRI in salivary gland masses and to compare the MRI findings with the final diagnosis achieved on clinical follow-up, histopathological examination, or operative findings. It was a cross-sectional study with a sample size of 30 patients. Ethical clearance was taken. The inclusion criteria included patients of any age or sex presenting with a salivary gland mass lesion. Patients with a salivary gland infection, xylolithiasis, or with contraindications to MRI were excluded from our study. USG and MRI were done in all patients, and histopathological examination using FNAC was done for the final diagnosis. Sonographic and MRI findings were compared with clinical follow-up, operative, or histopathological findings. Statistical analysis was done as appropriate. Now coming to the cases. This is the case of right parotid lymphadenitis, which shows a rounded hypoechoic lesion on ultrasound, appearing hyperintense on T1, heterogeneous, hyperintense on T2, heterogeneous on T1, with no significant contrast enhancement. Here is a case of bilateral parotid lymphadenitis, with multiple lesions throughout bilateral parotid glands, which are isointense on T1, hyperintense on T2, with no significant contrast enhancement. Our case of right parotid abscess showed a hypoechoic lesion with echogenic debris on ultrasound. It appeared hyperintense on T2, hypo on T1, with peripheral contrast enhancement. Here is a case of bilateral benign lymphoepithelial lesions, where both the parotid glands were bulky with multiple tiny lesions throughout, which appear isointense on T1, hyperintense on T2, with no significant contrast enhancement. Here's a pleomorphic adenoma of the right submandibular gland. It appeared lobulated and hypoechoic on ultrasound, and on MRI, it was hyperintense on T2 with heterogeneous contrast enhancement. Here's a pleomorphic adenoma of the left parotid showing oncocytic change. The lesion appeared hypoechoic on ultrasound with hyperintense areas on T2, which indicates the oncocytic change, while the solid part showed contrast enhancement. Here's a Wharton tumor of the left parotid with cystic change. The ultrasound showed a hypoechoic lesion with the anechoic component corresponding to the cystic part. The cystic component appeared hyperintense on T2, whereas the solid part showed contrast enhancement. In our study, the most common lesions were neoplastic, as you can see from the pie chart, and most common of them was pleomorphic adenoma. Among the inflammatory conditions, the most common was reactive lymphadenitis. 90% of the cases matched in the MRI findings with the histopathological diagnosis. Here is a table showing distribution of the patients according to the final diagnosis, where we see that the most common neoplastic condition was pleomorphic adenoma. The most common inflammatory condition was reactive lymphadenitis. And here is a table describing the lesion on MRI. Here's another table showing the signal characteristics of the lesion on MRI. In our study, major salivary gland diseases were divided into two groups based on the final diagnosis: inflammatory, which was 26.66%, and neoplastic, 73.32%. So the most common type of disease in our study were the benign tumors, 22. And in benign tumors, pleomorphic adenoma was the most common, followed by what? In the present study, the youngest patient was 18 years, oldest was 61 years, and the mean age was 39.5 years. Out of the 30 cases, 16 were male and 14 were female. So the male-female ratio was almost similar, around 8:7. However, males were seen to be affected more in the extremes of ages, whereas inflammatory swellings were commoner in females. And as we've already said, out of the 30 cases, 27, that's 90%, were accurately diagnosed on MRI. In conclusion, MRI is a safe and reliable imaging modality of choice for most of the salivary gland diseases and can be used for the delineation of location and regional extension, and is mostly accurate in making a histopathological diagnosis. However, the definitive diagnosis is still made by a tissue diagnosis such as FNSE or core biopsy. Here are the references for my study. Thank you for your patient listening.